Hey, good morning, everyone. My name's Tom, and I am the interim minister here at New Era Reformed Church, and it's good to see you this morning on this beautiful Sunday, and the third Sunday in Advent, that we're headed toward Christmas in our worship themes and services, and it's just great to see all of you today, alive and awake this morning. Wonderful. So before we get started with our worship service, though, we don't like anybody to feel unwelcome, so why don't you stand and share a greeting with each other, please. From Hebrews chapter 1. On many past occasions and in various ways, God has spoken to us through the prophets and his word. But in these last days, he has spoken to us through his Son, through whom which he made all things. The Son is the radiance of God's glory and the exact representation of his nature. And when he made purifications for sins, he sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Sing. Angels from the realms of glory, wing your flight o'er all the earth. He who sang creation's story now proclaim Messiah's birth. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Shepherds in the fields abiding, watching o'er your flocks by night. God with us is now resigned, yonder shines the infant light. Come and worship, come and worship, worship Christ the newborn King. Worship Christ the newborn King. Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply echo. Deo,
I'd like to invite Lynn up right now. She's going to light the third candle for us, which is called the Joy Candle. And if we can get the clicker to work this morning.
There's a person operating it.
There you go. All right. The scripture says from Luke 2, verses 10 through 11, "And the angel said to them, 'Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord.'" And so we focus on that joy today, that the coming of Christ is a great news of joy for us, the Word made flesh. And we give God thanks for that this morning. If you take out the half sheet that is entitled "The Word Became Flesh, Week 3, you'll see there I've written a few thoughts about that phrase. And then also, we have a hymn of the week that we want to meditate on this week. And one of my favorite, maybe my favorite, my favorite hymn writer in the history of the church is a gentleman named Charles Wesley. And he was a brother to John Wesley. And the Wesleys were part of really starting a great revival in the 1700s in Great Britain. And they say because of the Wesleyan revival in England, saved England from a violent revolution. And just had a powerful ministry there. And Wesley, Charles Wesley, was a prolific hymn writer. And he wrote this hymn. And I'd just like to read this to you. "Many of the carols we sing have a rich theological tradition, and Hark, the Herald Angels Sing is no exception. It was written by Charles Wesley, who was an English Methodist leader and hymn writer. Wesley wrote over 6,000 hymns, more than any other male hymn writer in the church. Fanny Crosby wrote 8,000 hymns and gospel hymns. His goal in writing hymns was to teach the poor and illiterate sound doctrine. His brother John Wesley, a famous theologian and founder of Methodism, said that Charles' hymnal was the best theological textbook in existence. Some have noted that Methodism was born in song, and Charles was the chief songwriter. Wesley, inspired by the sounds of London church bells while walking to church on Christmas Day, wrote Hark, the Hark poem, about a year after his conversion, to be read on Christmas Day. Veiled in flesh, the Godhead see, hail the incarnate deity, pleased as man with men to dwell, Jesus, our Emmanuel. Hark, the herald angels sing, glory to the newborn king." So I think we're going to stand and sing that right now. Let's do that.
Mind, God and sinners, red, no sign.
I'm going to ask Johan to come up and has an announcement to share from the mission team.
Hi, morning. Good. We have an opportunity through Rick Eschenberg to be involved in a prison ministry, which we all know Rick is pretty well involved in. And he's saying to us that Chaplain Bill Ryder is planning on 65 give bags for inmates, and that would be for the Oceana County area. And he's planning a packing party on Wednesday, December the 22nd at 6 p.m. at Faith Christian Fellowship in Hart, 400 South Hart Street in Hart. And they are asking that whatever we buy, which is really what they're going to ask us to do, or help them at least with, should be able to fit in a paper lunch size bag. And the things we need is store-bought cookies, preferably Christmas cookies, but Oreos or any such would probably work as well. Word search books, no staples, please, in the books. Or Sudoku, also no staples. Single packs of coffee creamer or single packs of sugar for coffee or candy. And or help with the cost of these 65 bags that are going to be made up. Preferably cash in envelopes. We can still bring it here to the church next Sunday, and or just clearly mark the envelopes that it is for the prison ministry. And Jean Fleming can be contacted, you know, but it's such short notice. Probably let's just bring everything to the church here next Sunday. And if you do want to go to the packing party, you're more than welcome to go and join it. And then according to Rick, Faith Christian Fellowship is also planning on giving gift cards, $10 or so, to all Oceana County law enforcement officials, EMT, first responders, on either a state, a city, or a county level. So it would really be appreciated. And I think what we need to realize is this is in our own backyard, our own county. This is a ministry, a mission, an outreach, whatever you want to call it, just to make people realize that we really care and show them that we really care and just share the story of Christ with them as well. So if anybody needs any information, you can contact me, Laurie, Jean, anybody on the mission committee, and we will try and help. Thank you.
Thanks, Johan. A couple other things that we as a church can be involved with in this Christmas season. Wednesday night, we have our kids program going on here. Gracie is in charge of that, and they are having their program this Wednesday, inviting the families, parents, grandparents, whoever, to come and be a part of that, and they will put on a program. I'm assuming tell the Christmas story, share Jesus with them. And we are, as a church, all invited to come and be a part of that if you would like. It is at 7 o'clock here on Wednesday, and it will not be long, so don't be late. But just come. Show support to the program, to those kids, to those families. Interact with them. Get to know them. So Wednesday night at 7 to be a part of that with the kids. Also, there was a Love Fund gift for the King Home purchased. A large television that they were needing. And so the consistory has bought that, and they are looking for anybody who would like to be a part of the delivery party to bring that over to the King Home and just bless them with that. And Ann Bile is in charge of that, so if that's something you would like to be interested in, I don't know when that's happening, but talk to Ann. She'll... Okay, all right. So if you're interested, we'll arrange it around the schedule of those people. So that's another opportunity for us. The deacons want me to let you know that the noisy offering last week weighed a total of 52.6 pounds. So that was a great support for the Christmas basket program, the giveaway that we do as a county. So thank you for that. There you go. Reminder that there is a consistory information meeting today after the service in the fellowship hall to go over some financial updates and to look at a potential sale of The Rock, the church building up the street. So if you'd like some more information about that, stick around. Consistory will be there for questions and to answer anything you have there. And then just a follow-up about a Christmas service happening again December 19, Sunday night, a week from today, 6 p.m., I've heard a lot of great things about people handing out a lot of invitations. There is a lot more left out there, so take some more. If you know of a place that you can put them in a, you know, at a checkout lane or another church or whatever, any place that you think there would be people that might pick them up, we could maybe think that every one of those cards out there has somebody's name on it. So, and it just needs to get delivered to that person. So take a handful. Again, there's no purpose to those cards after the 19th. So let's get them out there. I'm excited that Paula Medinan is arranging some fellowship time afterwards with cookies and punch, some cheese and such. So there will be a time for fellowship afterwards with people. Connie White is arranging some kids activities during the service. So if families come with kids ages, say 3 to 6-ish, there will be some great Christmas activities for them to hear their own level of the Christmas story. So if you know of families that have little kids, please encourage them to come and that their kids will have a chance to interact with that. So thank you, Connie, for doing that. So just please think about that. Think about who we can invite, who we can include. We'd like to fill this place up and share the Christmas story with as many people as possible. So thank you.
Let's go to God in prayer at this time. Father, we thank you today for our breath, for our life. We thank you for your love for us, which is made so tangible in the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. We celebrate today that the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. The joy the shepherds must have felt, we ask, could be made a reality in our hearts and in our lives, that we may comprehend more fully the magnificent gift that you've given to us in the person of our Savior. We pray too, God, for the joy of this season, to be able to permeate hearts that are hurting today. We want to pray especially for those whose lives have been touched profoundly with grief this year and during this season, that they may find hope and they may find a special touch from your love. We pray that as God's people, we would have the capacity to reach out to those who are hurting and need an extra touch of love. We pray too, God, for those that are in prison. Jesus said, I was in prison and you visited me. We know we can't visit prison now because of COVID and other things, but we pray, God, that our gifts would be received and that the prisoners who receive them would sense the love of God, the friendliness of our congregation as we share with them gifts and encouragement and the good news of Christ. We ask God for spiritual renewal in our own lives. Lord, we pray that your Spirit will work in our church, in our congregation, in our lives individually, that you will continue to transform us into the image of Christ, that we will leave our sin behind, that we will turn to you, God, and that you will create us through the power of your Spirit, make us be the people of God that you've called us to be, that you'll create a hearts that have a greater capacity to love you and to know you and to serve you. And that is our prayer and our longing today. God, we pray too this morning for the fruitfulness of the Christmas service that we're planning. We ask for folks to have a desire to come, especially folks that maybe drifted from you or don't know you, that the service could be a blessing to them, that their hearts might be open through your Spirit and would want to come and to follow Jesus and to know him. We thank you, God, for all of the ministries that we share here at our congregation. We pray that the Holy Spirit would bless each of them, that you help us minister to our children and in turn help our children to become your servants. We pray for growing ministries for adults among us, that you will bless us, raise up people to serve who are interested in ministering through the power of your Spirit in that way. Lord, as we continue in worship now, we ask your blessing on our service. In Jesus' name, amen.
I want to draw attention to some lyrics in this next song. He has come for us, this Jesus. He's hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life. How good is that?
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Savior was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power when we were gone astray. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. He has come for us, this Jesus. He's the hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life. From God our Heavenly Father, the blessed angel came, and unto certain shepherds brought tidings of the same. How that in Bethlehem was born the Son of God by name. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy, comfort and joy. Oh, tidings of comfort and joy. He has come for us, this Jesus. He's the hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life. All the angels sing hallelujah. Jesus Christ is born. All the children sing hallelujah. He is Christ the Lord. He has come for us, this Jesus. He's the hope for all mankind. He has come for us, the Messiah, born to give us life. He is born to give us life. Angels sing hallelujah. Jesus Christ is Lord. All the children sing hallelujah. He is Christ the Lord.
Lord, we are so blessed. We are so blessed that you sent your Son to this earth to save us. He is Lord. In this season, let us just celebrate that. Lord, you are good, and we are blessed. Let us be a blessing. It's in your name that we pray. Amen.
With you, would you turn with me to the Gospel of John? I'd like to read verses 1 through 14 this morning. Hear the word of God. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, but the darkness has not understood it. There came a man who was sent from God. His name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all men might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to every man was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision, or of a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. And I really just want to reflect this morning on the first sentence of verse 14, the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. This is God's Word. May there be praise in the church because of it. There was a family with young children eagerly awaiting Christmas morning, and when the day finally came, the children were all geeked and out of bed early, dragging their parents before the Christmas tree, and they tore into their Christmas gifts, and as they opened their gifts, there was wrapping paper flying all over the place, and the parents watched those presents just go up in smoke. What had taken them hours to wrap and shop for was all done in about 30 minutes. I imagine many of you know what that experience is like. But after about 30 minutes, the wild fiasco was over. With all the gifts unwrapped, one of the children looked at his brothers and sisters and said this, is that it? Is that all there is? Right? And man, I hope, one thing for sure, I hope those kids got a lesson in gratitude at some point in their lives. I know that for me, it used to be when our kids were home, the three most feared words in the English language were some assembly required on Sunday morning. You know, I think there are many people asking that question about life today. Maybe you're asking that question about life today. Is that all there is? You know, as the children are tearing through the presents, we are a culture and society tearing through life, tearing through the gifts, tearing through all the things that our culture has wrapped for us and told us that we need to do and need to have to be happy and to find fulfillment. And finally, we're experiencing the fact that they're not enough. We seek to satisfy our egos with job titles and our fulfillment with toy after toy or with a fulfillment for the heart that's empty with relationship after relationship. And ultimately, each of us must own our own sadness, come to grips with it. We ask that question, is that all there is? We keep chasing and we keep chasing. It would seem, and C.S. Lewis said this in a book called The Weight of Glory and Other Addresses. He says, it would seem that our Lord finds our desires not too strong but too weak. We are half-hearted creatures fooling about with drink and sex and ambition when infinite joy is offered to us. Like an ignorant child who wants to go on making mud pies in a slum because he cannot imagine what is meant by the offer of a holiday at sea. We are far too easily pleased, said C.S. Lewis, and he was talking about the joy of knowing Christ and really finding life in Jesus. I think that with what we truly have before us in Advent season, is the seminal question for the ages of mankind and womankind. Does what happened 2,000 years ago really make a difference? Or at the end of the day, do we shrug our shoulders like the kids did on Christmas morning and say, is that all there is? Isn't there anything else? Is it going to be more of the experience of nothingness, like everything we just, as I said, yawn and keep going? But then a cannonball goes off in John 1:14. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. And we've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. It is impossible to encounter this Jesus, I believe, and say that's all there is. And today I want to spend a few minutes breaking down for us what is encouraged and entitled, what's included in this little phrase, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and how that, I think, answers that question. That is that all there is, that we can never really fully explore the depths of God's love and know it fully. I think the first thing that grips me as I look at this passage and I think about the meaning of my own life and destiny, and I hope for you as well, is that everything about us as people matters, body and soul. Everything about us matters. Our loves, our joys, our fears, our concerns, our relationships, our service for Christ, all of it matters intensely. Now, we know from our study of the New Testament and the early church writings, and I want to go through the weeds here for just a minute, so I encourage you to stay with me, that one of the biggest threats to the truth of Christ's incarnation that we celebrate at Christmas was something called Gnosticism. Can you say that word? Gnosticism. G starts with a G. G-N-O-S-T and so forth and so on. You find where maybe New Testament writers don't specifically mention that word, but the New Testament writers in their writing are repudiating that philosophy of life or that belief. It's from the Greek world. And there are many Gnostics today, even, and some of it has still creeped into the church today. But it's more, I want to give you a definition of Gnosticism, and it's more complicated than what I'm going to say it is, but I'm going to give you a simple summary of one of their basic beliefs that is a significant threat to the gospel, and I think alters life meaningless ultimately. Gnosticism taught this. And it was a Greek philosophy. The whole world of the New Testament was filled with it. And as the Greeks came into the church, it was very difficult for them to leave this worldview behind. And so we see the New Testament authors talking about this. It says that, and this is basically the foundation of their belief system, was that there was this duality of matter and spirit, that the creation, everything that was you could touch and see and feel, you know, your skin on your flesh, your bones, everything that was matter was evil. Okay, and everything that was spirit was good. That was called a Greek duality, and that's what they believed in the Greek world, and it was the undergirding philosophy of all of life. And so the ultimate goal of Greek philosophy was to have a view of life that the ultimate goal was to be released from your body, because your body didn't matter. And that's why we see in Corinthians that they were the most immoral church in the New Testament, because certainly a Greek worldview had influenced them, that if my body doesn't matter, morality doesn't matter, right? And you see some of the sins taking place in the Corinthian church. And Paul says, don't you know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit, right? That your bodies aren't a piece of garbage, and that we're not made whole until there's a resurrection of the dead. And we get the greatest teaching in the New Testament about the resurrection of the dead in 1 Corinthians 13. Because Paul says all of creation matters to God. And that we're not, the Bible teaches us, we're not whole human beings until we're really body and soul. Okay, and finally, on the day of resurrection, when Christ comes back, we're going to be physically resurrected. God cares about our bodies. God cares about our whole lives. Okay, and so this phrase, the Word became flesh, it is a bomb going off in the Greek world. Okay, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. It was so crucial to biblical Christianity. 1 John 4, verse 2, we read this. By this you know the Spirit of God. Every spirit that confesses that Jesus Christ has come in the flesh is from God. Every spirit that does not confess Jesus in the flesh is not from God. That is the spirit of the Antichrist. And as I said in 1 Corinthians, Paul gives a beautiful explanation of the resurrection. The Word became flesh. It means everything about it. Every spiritual, every aspect of our lives, okay? Every physical aspect of our lives matter to God. Humanity is body and soul. Jesus came to save us, body and soul, because all of life matters. The goal of our faith isn't just to be a soul released from this body. So, I remember a few years ago, I was at a Christmas party of a junior high youth groups from several churches, and the junior high ministries had hired a Christian magician to come and perform for the kids. He was really a good and talented magician. He was not very good at taking care of himself. That's all I'm going to say about that. But nonetheless, his show was outstanding. The kids enjoyed it thoroughly. Then he shared his personal testimony, how he came to know Jesus. No doubt, very meaningful to him and important. He said, though, this thing at the end of his testimony: I can't wait to go to heaven to be with Jesus and leave my body behind, because my body is just a piece of garbage anyway. Wow. It was striking, because although he was well-intentioned, he was incredibly wrong. He said, you know, if you're a Christian, you understand that our bodies are just really pieces of junk, that when we die, they're only good for the garbage dump. The body is just a temporary housing unit that we can dispose of when we get to heaven. And friends, my fear is that sometimes that kind of outlook is not all that uncommon in faith community. It's the kind of thinking that leads to the inevitable conclusion that the spiritual realm is good and the physical realm is bad. Drawing this distinction has allowed people of faith to embrace ministries that are only concerned about sharing the word of Christ and not ministering to the physical needs of people. As Reformed Christians, as we've gone to the mission field, we've always cared about hungry people. And we've always cared about sick people in our mission work, because the body is important to God. And he calls us to that kind of ministry, okay? And of course, if we aren't concerned about bodies, we don't need to be really concerned about morality. That's why, also, as we consider Jesus calling himself, as he says to Paul, as he's persecuting the Christians, why do you persecute me? Jesus says there's a mystical connection between himself and his church. And that's why, as a culture, it is so easy for people to separate their spirituality from their morality. You see, why live in purity before God when my body doesn't matter? That's why Paul said to the Corinthians that our bodies belong to God. They're temples of the Holy Spirit. That's why I think it's so easy for many people, even confused Christians, to say, I don't go to church, but I am a spiritual person. How many of you have heard that hunk of baloney? That's crazy. All that is a slimy excuse for not wanting to make a commitment. That's all that is. And if you don't like it, I'll meet you in my office afterwards. All right? That's all it is an excuse for an unwillingness to make a commitment. Because God cares for all of us. And when we have a spiritual commitment, we bring our bodies along with it. And when we have a spiritual commitment, we're committed to the body of Christ. And we're involved in it as well. You see, only when you draw distinctions between this, the physical and the spiritual, can you say your spirituality is divorced from anything else at all. So, indeed, the Word made flesh is a lightning bolt that goes throughout the entire universe. It tells us the creation matters to God. It tells us the stars and the sun and the moon matter to God. It tells us all the earth matters to God. It tells us that your body, your life, everything about you matters to Jesus Christ. And so, with all due respect to our magician friend, the goal is not to be liberated from what is physical, but the goal is to see our bodies and all of creation as a gift that God is redeeming. Because God was once a child who needed to be fed and rocked to sleep. Right? Now the act of feeding and rocking children to sleep is sacred. Because God was once a boy who got lost from his parents in Jerusalem, the act of parenting is potentially sacred. Because God was once a carpenter, work is sacred. Because God once ate and celebrated with friends, sitting down to share a meal with friends is a sacred act as a follower of Jesus. Because Jesus wept, the act of grieving is sacred. Because God was in this world, everything we do in this world has the potential to point us toward Jesus. So is that all there is? There's quite a bit there. There's a whole lot there. Jesus, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Now, there's one more implication I want to draw our attention to this morning about this beautiful phrase, the Word became flesh. Charles Wesley put it so beautifully, veiled in flesh, the Godhead see. The Word became flesh is that Jesus is real to you. He's real to us corporately. He's alive. He's with us through the power of the Spirit. Now, Philippians 2, Paul doesn't say the Word became flesh. He talks about the incarnation in a little bit of a different way as he describes the event of that John says the Word became flesh. Listen to how Paul kind of fills in some of that. He says, talks about Jesus, who existing in the form of God did not consider equality with God something to be literally selfishly clung on to, but he emptied himself. Jesus emptied himself. The Greek word is kenosis. And theologians have been debating for two centuries, we're not going to solve it here this morning, exactly what was the extent of the emptying, the kenosis of Jesus. That he emptied himself and he became a servant, taking the form of a servant, being made in human likeness and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient even to death and death on a cross. You see, I think Paul's take on the incarnation here sheds a little more light on the scope of the resurrection and all of life and what it means for us. He speaks of the humility of Jesus. He speaks of the condescension of Jesus. He speaks of the servanthood of Jesus. The Son of Man came not to serve, but to be served, and to give his life as a ransom for many. That emptying process was so magnificent and incredible that the Son of God gave his seat of glory up. He came in human form. He certainly was limited in some capacities by his humanity until he was again ascended to the throne in heaven, okay? He emptied himself, taking the form of a servant, meaning he is with us. Hebrews says this, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who's been tempted in every way just as we are, yet he did not sin. Why is that? Because the Word became flesh. You see, we don't serve a Jesus that's coldly detached from our temptations and from our suffering, our grief and our pain. But the scripture says Jesus suffered and was tempted in every way that we are because of his humanity and the incarnation. You see, he not only assumed all the normal things that come with a normal life of human, of being human, but he also accepted the very darkest moments of our experience with him. When the Word became flesh, he lived a life that experienced joy and purpose and fulfillment, but he also lived a life that experienced the greatest of human suffering. Did Jesus get angry? Yes, he did. Did Jesus feel fatigue? Yes, he did. Did he know emotional exhaustion? Yes, he did. Did Jesus find there were people he didn't care to be with very much? Yes, he did. Did Jesus feel deep sadness and grief? Yes, he did. Did Jesus know what it's like to struggle with despair? Yes. Yes, he did. You see, Jesus lived every experience we do, breathing the air we breathe, struggling with people like we do, feeling the highs and lows of ordinary human life and existence, and then experiencing the painful suffering of the wrath of God on the cross for our sins. You see, when one understands that God understands, then the distance between us and Jesus is more easily bridged. In a personal way. You see, why is that important? It means that there's no suffering we can imagine that Jesus cannot help us with. It means there's no experience that we cannot reframe in a redemptive way because of Jesus. Wow. You see, but the first time we are brought face to face with the brokenness that this world offers us, it's so tempting to doubt, is it not? In Hebrews 2:18, says, therefore, he, Christ, had to be made like his brothers and sisters in every respect because he himself has suffered when tempted. He is able to help those who are being tempted. You see, there, the Word made flesh, yes, Christmas is the time to remember. There is nothing that we can go through that Christ has not been through. When we are utterly convinced that God is unfair and unjust and out of touch, the Word made flesh is with us. Jesus said, in this world, you'll have trials and tribulations. Be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. You know, last night we were babysitting the grandchildren. I got beat in basketball by our 12-year-old. I got beat up by our 5-year-old. I need ice today after that experience. But last night I got a text message that I wish I wouldn't have gotten. Brian and Shelley Wilson, they live now in Byron Center, but for years they lived in Jenison. I was their pastor, and I haven't seen them for probably 15 years. Their son Brady is 38 years old, passed away yesterday. And my heart just aches for my friends. My son went to school with him, with Brady. They were friends, played sports together. Brady had an enlarged heart. I didn't know it. Now he's with Jesus. I did not want to get that text message last night. They asked me to do the funeral, which I'm very happy and honored to do. But we need Jesus, man. We need Jesus. The only thing that sustains us is the hope of the resurrection. Because if the Word isn't made flesh, all we can say is that all there is. It's the grave. Is that all there is? But John shouts, he says, the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. Final thought, moving along here. The implication also is that those who follow Jesus are called to ministry in this world, not to escape it. You know, the example of living God's mission was that Jesus was what Jesus was all about. It's so true that when we often say we follow Jesus, it's easy to forget our lives and our community of faith is called to live that same mission. So great to hear the report this morning about the prison ministry. That's the mission of Jesus. And it's especially easy to forget that we are supposed to follow Jesus. Jesus made the sick, the sinful, the suffering of the world. Those were the places he went. Jesus was indeed a person sold out to the practice of prayer and worship. And so we should be sold out to these things too. Jesus worshiped every Sabbath. But as the Word became flesh, This word went down a path that led him straight to the world and to embrace all of the world's messes. You see, as people so loved by God and called by God to partner with him in mission, if we hide away, seclude ourselves from the messiness of life, we're no longer walking the path of the Word made flesh from heaven to earth. We are his people. We are his hands and his feet. If we sit back with our eyes on heaven, ignore the world, we don't follow Jesus. There's a story it's been told by a number of authors. A little girl is afraid of sleeping alone at night, and so she runs to her mother for comfort. Her mother, sensing an opportunity for a spiritual and theological lesson, tells the girl she doesn't have to be afraid because God is there. And as she's tucking the girl back in, she explains that, well, God may be everywhere, but I need a God with skin on right now. I need a God with skin on right now. We are the hands and feet of Jesus in this world. We're the body of Christ. People need representatives of Jesus with skin on to be in their lives. When the Word became flesh, God took on skin. God became a person. He'd walk beside us. He'd play with us. He'd eat with us. He'd hug us. He'd forgive us, go to the cross for us, and he would rise from the dead, and he would ascend in glory to the right hand of God the Father. He is worthy of praise. Let's pray together. Father, thank you today for this word. Bless it to our hearts that we may honor and live for this Christ, whom we love. In Jesus' name, amen.
The world waits for a miracle. The heart longs for a little bit of hope. Oh, come, Emmanuel. A child prays for peace on earth, and she's calling out from a sea of hurt. Oh, come, Emmanuel. Can you mother, a baby's cry is the sound of love come.
Grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now and always. Amen. Y'all have a great day.
Glory.